He finishes his 65th year today, so this was a perfect honor, perfect occasion to commemorate his lifetime contribution, intellectual contribution to the thinking, geoeconomics thinking in India and globally. We are joined by Honorable Minister and panelists already on the dais. Minister has to leave at 11:50. Yeah? Okay. All right. So without much ado, let me invite Mr. Shakti Sinha to deliver the opening remarks. Thank you.
Very good morning to everybody. Gives me great pleasure to welcome the Honorable Minister for Housing and Urban Affairs and Civil Aviation, Government of India, Mr. Deep Puri, the man of the day, the person of the day, Sanjaya Baru. Of course, yes, Tali Uli Bajana. Study Peta Kats, Swasthi Haider, and Bhashti Mukherjee and Bajra Mukherjee. We always like to use the platform of Nehru Memorial to do different things every now and then. And I'm happy that we're using it for the launching of this fresh shift in the academic world where Sanjaya once belonged to. But I'm sure he still retains some link with it. A festive is a very important piece of work. When people gather, basically, to celebrate the life of a scholar on her, his 60th birthday, 65th birthday, whatever it is, you know. And therefore, a lot of effort goes into it and a lot of, what should I say, sign of recognition that yes, we are now accepting you as a guru now. If you remember the movie, A Beautiful Mind, about John Nash, there at the end when he's finally accepted, everybody comes to his table and leaves behind a pen kind of a thing. This is the kind of tribute you pay. So this is what we're doing here today. I don't think so you're very much interested in my speaking. We have a galaxy of very good speakers, panelists to discuss a lot of subjects. But yes, it gives me great pleasure to collaborate with Kats, with Pradeep Mehta and his team, Vipul, Abhishek, others. Always at the forefront of bringing out the key economic issues facing the country and doing so fairly bluntly also, but also in a very practical manner in their newsletters, in the seminar they attend, in the op-ed that they write, and in the theme of economic reforms in the real sense of improving investment climate as an example. Kats is right at the forefront. So at Nehru Memorial, very glad to associate, very glad to partner with Pradeep and Kats team in doing this event. And in the past we've done it, and I'm sure in the future also Pradeep will do that. Once again, it's a great pleasure to welcome all of you.
Thank you very much, Shakti. And indeed, it's a. Let me join you in welcoming all, and particularly Minister Hardeep Puri, for having agreed to grace the occasion and to not only release this festive that we have published in honor of Dr. Sanjaya Baru. They're all very, very, very old friends. And Shakti, as you mentioned, that. Well, I wouldn't say that we have been blunt, but we've been certainly candid. We hold a view on many of these issues. In fact, we're very extremely happy that Minister Puri will be releasing this book, and will also be participating in the panel discussion for a little while as he can. When we finished compiling this book and we put out this notice for this particular event, we got a very nice email from the noted economist, Professor Jagdish Bhagwati. He says, and his words are very relevant here, not only is this a well-deserved tribute to Sanjay, but Hardeep Puri's mastery of trade issues cries out to be brought to the attention of Prime Minister Modi. And in fact, Shakti, you forgot to mention, but Hardeep is also a Minister of State in the in Ministry of Commerce and Industry. We spent a whole day with him in a meeting of the Board of Trade, which just met the other day, about a month ago, and I could see the presence, the erudite presence which Hardeep brought into the discussion at that particular forum, in addition to what the Minister Piyush Goyal was managing. And we have a crisis in the country, undoubtedly. In our exports are going down. I mean, there is a global phenomenon about it. So it is not as if things are happening which are bad to India. I mean, in the overall, our growth rate continues to be on the positive side, 5+, if not more. And how we are going to grow, and this is something which we need to send a message across to our policymakers, which Minister Puri doesn't need to be said, that exports are the way to higher growth. You cannot be an autarkic nation and hope that we can continue to grow without exploring the markets abroad. And one of the areas where we think there have been recently a meeting also held is on how we can exploit our relations or use our relations with the U.S. to see to it that we are able to expand our trade, because that is one of the biggest markets for India. And at the same time, it is the only Western economy which is growing at a very decent pace. And there are problems with the administration there and the kind of friction that we are having. But that is something which we would like to implore upon Minister Puri to see as to how it can be best addressed, given the uncertainty and unpredictability of many of these issues. Now, without further ado, let me request Minister Puri to please address the audience. Thank you. And release the book. Sorry, could you? I will just hold it up. We'll just hold it up.
Dr. Baru, Ambassador Mukherjee, if I may be permitted to address you as such, Suhasini, Pradeep, Sanjay, friends, ladies and gentlemen, I felt deeply honored when Pradeep sent me a message inviting me to be with you this morning. Not that my response time has slowed down after entering this other world, I call it the other world, but I normally make commitments only when I'm sure that I don't have to last minute cry off. And since this was a Saturday morning, I was a little wary, but I tried to clear my calendar to the best of my ability, including an event which had to be rescheduled. But I felt deeply honored because in many respects, I think Sanjay, who has responded to and worn so many hats with equal aplomb, academic, journalist, advisor to one prime minister in-house, a contributor to an earlier prime minister in terms of the evolving architecture of that point, I've had the privilege of knowing him, and therefore I felt very good to receive this invitation. On the way into the auditorium, he reminded me that one of his first assignments that he undertook, I don't know whether it was first, that's you mentioned a BIMSTEC paper you wrote for the Ministry of External Affairs, commissioned by a joint secretary called Lakshmi Puri. And what I did recall was that of all the other professional distinctions that he has held, The think tank part was missing because he was with RIS also. So let me just say that we are all very fortunate that we have Sanjay Baru, who to whom so many tributes have been paid that I'm not going to repeat those. But I want to get a little and recall one or two stories which many of you will be unfamiliar with, but I'm sure Sanjay will recall this. The year was 1992, if I remember. I had just taken over as Joint Secretary on the Americas desk. I received a call from a man whom, I would address Ambassador Mukherjee, so I would say he was known as Mr. TCA Srinivas Vardhan, no, Srinivas Raghavan. Huh? Where is he?
No.
Ah, there he is. But we had another name for him in the Hindu College hostel, which I cannot repeat. That's what that's the point I was wanting to make. So he said that, you know, we have an editor and he wants to discuss the United States. And I had just handed over as the staff officer to Mr. Dixit, who was then the foreign secretary. And I think the time was May 1982, if I remember correctly. And he wanted to talk about the United States. Now, one good thing about the United States, when you have a discussion today, and I hope to participate in your panel, is that it is possible for us to have misgivings on one issue and yet realize the imperative of engaging the United States for a number of reasons. But the world of 1992 was a little different. The world of 1992 was divided between people who I think had an understanding of the world and people who just were totally engrossed with their own mental cobwebs. So the three areas on which there was a real need to evolve our own thinking in order to be able to engage the United States, one was, of course, the multilateral trading system. Fact is that after the Tokyo round, which was a pretty simple affair, you were dealing with goods as they crossed borders and you imposed tariffs and non-tariff measures. You were now in a different world where there was a demand to open up the universe of commerce and deal with issues like trade and services, investment measures, and go right into the, domestic production processes. I mean, you were reordering the world in a way. This was one. The second was, I have no doubt that the policy of the United States on the nuclear issue at that point of time was very clearly to cap and roll back our nuclear program. I mean, there was no doubt about it. And then I can come to another thing. There was this interventionist urge. The interventionist urge being that, we know what's good for you. We don't think we have enough confidence that you can sort out your problems with your Western neighbor. And, we are ready to offer our good services. And that formulation was couched in varying degrees of nuance, depending on whom they were speaking to. And I had the unique privilege of dealing with a person who had a not so senior position in the U.S. Embassy here. She was a counselor, I think. Now that I'm old, I refer to counselors as not so senior, but I can be forgiven for that. She goes back, becomes Deputy Assistant Secretary of State, and successive governments, I don't know why anybody had any doubts, but no Prime Minister that I know of would ever, go and suggest to the Americans that, you become our arbiters. Americans or anyone else. I mean, we learned our lessons in the second half of the 40s, after we became an independent country and made a reference to the Security Council on Kashmir. Anyway, coming back, she decided that one way she could open up our comfort zone would be to question the instrument of accession. Now, very few people know that when I read out the Riot Act to her in terms of telling her and anyone else with that thinking, where to get off, I actually was reading from a text which I had to read out to Ken Brill And every comma in that text was cleared by a man called Mr. P.V. Narasimha Rao. Now, I would obviously report to my foreign secretary. He would report to his boss. And he was very clear on the line of command. The foreign secretary reported to the prime minister then. Okay? I don't even know who the minister of external affairs was. But that's, I'm not, this is just a comment in passing. The point I'm making is, we got the message across. We told her where she got off. I think the message from the Indian side was there. And we succeeded remarkably in, I think, drawing the line. And I don't think anyone after that, I mean, there were a few feeble attempts, ever suggested to us that, you know, that was an issue which was negotiable. So I think that was very good. Now, but what happened subsequently is something that worries me. You know, you take a tough stand on the instrument of accession, which is absolutely, you have no other thing. You take a stand on trade policy. But ultimately, in your desire to work out a new architecture of relationship with the United States, you know, then you suddenly go around saying that, oh, wait a minute, maybe that line was too tough. So and you sacrifice a joint secretary in the process. I never really looked back. But the real issue came on the nuclear part. There were people within our system then who were quite happy in order to go down the area of accommodation. On the issue of Kashmir, I mean, very fact, I remember some one or two people who are quite prominent even now were quite happy to engage Robin Rafael. And I was saying, pointing out then, that this is not even an American line. This seems to be an agenda which is, you know, which is being pursued by some people with some other motive. And I think in retrospect, we were proved right, and the manner in which we were able to rid ourselves of some of these kinds of negotiators. But when it came to the nuclear issue, I was perplexed then, and I'm bringing this up because when you have a discussion on Indo-US relations, I think you should factor this in. I don't know what got into the then Prime Minister, because the organized bureaucracy, which meant people like myself and who was it, Rakesh Sood, was on the disarmament desk, because maybe we're plowing a tough line, I don't know what the issue was, they decided that they would hold secret talks in London, made up of four or five very eminent people from our side, and then this whole business of the secret talks leaked out. One view then, I had then, and which I am now increasingly subscribing to, that this was Shri Narasimha Rao at his Brahminical best. He said, first you engage, then you try, do something, and then when there is a furor on the secret talk, you say, what can I do? But you also remember that occasion, there was supposed to be a test, which got called off because the satellite imager had picked up activity there. Of course, the good thing is we learned from that lesson. Next time we done it, we found out when the satellite was hovering, so we did all the activity when the satellite's eyes were not on us. But I come back to making some very basic points. One, I would submit that when it came to dealing with issues of strategic issues, nuclear security, nuclear issue, and I think Shyam has said in his comment that, you know, Sanjay was with him in the trenches when you were negotiating the Indo-US nuclear deal. But not only on that issue, I think on trade policy per se, on the calibration of engaging and how to calibrate the engagement with the United States, I think Sanjay has been not only part of the narrative, but he's contributed to setting that narrative. So Sanjay, I want to pay you a tribute on that, and I mean every word of what I say, because I personally belong to a school of thought which says you cannot be a major economy, you cannot be an important economy in the world today unless you engage with the United States. I have not seen any country in the world grow rich without substantively engaging with the United States. That's the case of post-war Europe, that's the case with Japan. Well, the Chinese have a different model, and I could go on for a long time, but I think that's where the fault lines are now going to be emerging. So I would say that two things. We must respect the fact that robust political systems choose their own leaders. And you must allow the electorate, wherever, to respond to that. But you fashion your relationship with another country based on your own strengths, your weaknesses, your vision in terms of what you want to grow into. And I have absolutely no doubt that the $5 trillion economy vision by 2024 or $10 trillion by 2030 will require a substantive engagement with the United States, which is today an $18 trillion economy, and by 2030 will be what, $25, $26 trillion economy? It requires engagement with the Chinese, who are today what, $11 trillion economy, and by then will be $13 or $15 trillion economy. But that's the name of the game. The name of the game is not to take highly subjective, value-loaded positions. You're either for or you're against. I think your job is to be for the system you're serving. And I think I'm glad that in our generation, we've had several people who were able to rise above their immediate affiliations, their political alignments, and to be able to see a vision for the country in terms of its dynamic potential and contribute towards realizing that potential. So, Sanjay, thank you for getting me here. I don't know if it's your decision or Pradeep's, but I'm willing to thank both of you. I'm also thankful for my that I was able to make it and be with you a little longer because my meeting just got postponed by half an hour. I can just add one or two other general comments, which is that our public discourse still, and I say this out of regret rather than, I'm not being critical, still is dominated by a very strong subjective streak. I personally believe that when it comes to the major issues of the day, I think, I was again going to call him by his Hindu college name, he lamented the fact that the BJP lacked economic thinkers. Well, I'd like to have a discussion with you on that. Your problem may be that the kind of economic thinkers we have may not be the ones that you are, in admiration of. But I think it's a little more complicated. What we are witnessing today in the world is that the so-called Western liberal Washington consensus kind of thing has had to take a back seat. People are increasingly suspicious of trade without acknowledging, and I think this is a big mistake, without acknowledging the fact that trade has been responsible for unprecedented prosperity, not only in the West but elsewhere also. The problem with that prosperity has been that the benefits of that have been unevenly distributed between people within a country and amongst countries. So there has been a reaction to that. And that reaction you see in the fact that I don't even know whether you should call them right-of-center parties, but parties whose political machinery and ideology is more responsive to loss of jobs, for instance. And that is what happened, and the narrative has not always been an easy narrative, because much of this perception is based on the conscious creation sometimes of a false narrative. So what happens in the process is that people take very strong position. And I think we ought to be able, before we start criticizing people, get down to the basic core facts. And by the way, I can tell you I was one of the few people, and I say this with great degree of pride, before the 2019 election, I was one of those who said we will get 300 plus. And let me just repeat to you why I said we would get 300 plus. I said, we are a party of 11 crore members. We call them karyakartas. In the 2014 election, we got 17 crore votes. I said the total number of beneficiaries of the Prime Minister's flagship programs, I mean talking about Swachh Bharat, Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana, Ayushman Bharat, etc., total number of beneficiaries is 22 crores. So, 11 crore members, 17 crore votes last time, and 22 crore beneficiaries of all these programs. Do you know how many votes we got in the 2019 election? 22 crore. I'm not trying to say that there is an exact coefficient or a correlationship between the number of beneficiaries of a development scheme and awards. But equally, my case is that if you've given somebody a Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana benefit, or if you've given somebody benefit under Ayushman Bharat, he's not likely to forget. So the nature of the debate has changed. Not only the people who are the beneficiaries, but those who are aspirants, who want those benefits. And equally, I come back, therefore, all this criticism that we had before the election, and I think, again, I hope Sanjay doesn't misunderstand this, but I think Sanjay was able to stand above this, and not only now, even in 2014, because I have, he wrote a book on a former prime minister, and I reviewed it in three parts. I used to have a regular blog, I think, in the Economic Times or sometime when I had more time on my hands. And I said, it's a great political party, a party which won India its independence. It has great stalwarts, people who founded the party, Jawaharlal Nehru, Mahatma Gandhi, who gave it a mass connect. But you cannot take that whole process and then combine it and make its fortunes dependent on a family. I don't think that is compatible. And that is where the strength of democracy comes. I think that's also where India is changing. And in order to become a $5 trillion or a $10 trillion economy, you've got to get your equations right on all these fronts. Where he has, you guys call it what? Geoeconomics. Okay? Absolutely. I think that is the thing. But you know, I'm surprised that some of us were new, surprised that we took to this. I remember when I was a young trade negotiator, I found that when I looked at the American list of trade negotiators, one of those guys rose to be head of the CIA. So I don't see much difference between strategic issues and hardcore economic issues, because that is where really the shaping is going to take place. I've probably spoken longer than I'd intended to, but thank you very much. And Sanjay, the best is still to come. So don't sit on this laurel and say, well, now they've all celebrated my success. Anyway, you've got to go on contributing. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you, Minister. May I now request Mr. Pradeep Mehta to conduct the proceedings for the panel discussion?
Before I invite Sanjay to come and speak, I thought we could straight away segue into the panel discussion. Okay, over to you.
And just in case your friends outside who want to know what's happening here, we are live streaming it. In fact, live streaming it. So I'm already getting reactions. Yes. So I've already got reactions to it.
I just wanted to say a few words of thanks before we get into the discussion on Indo-US relations. All my good friends said to me, fresh shifts are never written before you're 70. How come you're too young for a fresh shift? And the only explanation I have is that I have a friend called Pradeep Mehta who doesn't listen to reason. But I would like to say that about a little over a year ago when he came to me with this suggestion, I was bedridden for a month in extremely unwell. And, you know, it's a kind of a psychological moment when you wonder how long you live. I was seriously ill. And I think it was in that mental frame that I said yes. If you had asked me now, I would certainly have said no with the N capital, O capital. But I yielded to his persuasion in a moment of physical vulnerability. My only contribution to this effort, I should add, is of course Pradeep decided to build his own list, many of whom had found the time, some of whom didn't find the time. But I did say to him that I have a couple of friends outside India who have followed my work, and I'd like them to contribute to this essay. And two of them in particular I would like to mention. and draw your attention when you read the book. One is Sergei Karganov, who was an advisor to President Putin, with whom I've had a long association. And Sergei Karganov, when I first met him about 5 years ago, knew nothing about India. His entire focus, like most Russian elite and advisors to the leadership in Moscow, was Euro-focused. And I think I managed in the last 5 years to convince him that India was important. And today, and last year when I was Secretary General of FICCI, I invited him to come and deliver a lecture, which he did. And I'm truly grateful to him to have written this particular essay in this book, which I think is a very important comment on the world today. And the second is my friend Ravi Vallur, who's foreign affairs editor of Straits Times in Singapore, whom I have known over the years. And he has written a very different kind of essay, which again, in a sense, follows my own interest, which is on Indian soft power, Bollywood. But most of the others, I think, are names. Pardon?
Ravi is watching it this
time. He's watching it. Okay, thank you, Ravi, if you're watching it live. The second thing, my second contribution to this book was when Pradeep finished the book, he asked me who should write the foreword. And I had no doubt in my mind that the person I would have liked to at that point, this was about 6 months ago, was Mr. Arun Jaitley. Not just because he was, of course, the finance minister of India at that time, but Arunji has been someone I've known for the last 25 years, even when he was not a minister, even before the Vajpayee government. He's been a personal friend. I got to know him when he was the lawyer for the Times of India group, and I was an editor with the Times group, and those in the early 90s. But he's someone that I have over the years been the beneficiary of his affections, and I felt that he would be the appropriate person. So I'd again like to place on record my immense gratitude to Mr. Jaitley for having written a very warm foreword to the book. With these words, I just wanted to say thank you to Pradeep and to Abhishek, his young colleague, who put in the effort. Clearly, this is a very embarrassing moment. I guess, as Hardeep said, I this puts a lot of pressure on me to be eligible for this kind of a tribute. But thank you again, Hardeep, for being here. As he reminded us, I've known him thanks to TCA. I met him first in 1992, but he took me out for a fine meal in London when he was a Deputy High Commissioner, and we over the years had lots of conversations on trade and Indo-US relations, and therefore I'm delighted that he's here today, because the focus of our conversation over the next hour and a half would be on Indo-US relations. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Sanjay. Sanjay spoke about the fact that I approached him to do his first script. It's not because he was vulnerable, but I thought he's somebody who I've admired for a very long time. And he's been a great friend to me in many more ways than one. And he was without an organization at that particular time, if I'm not mistaken. So usually it's your organization who does it. In fact, he was editor of my first script when I turned 70 last year. So this is kind of a response to return favor. No, but then, Sanjay, it is 65 is a milestone. And when you turn 70, we'll do another one. So you have this...
Rev 2.
So you have this challenge before you that, you know, in 5 years' time, what more we can do together. And he's also on the board of our Washington, D.C. Center, which we started 1 year ago. So we do hope that we'll be doing a lot of other things. And particularly as Minister Puri spoke about, the fact is that we realize that the Indo-US relations are very critical for our economic reasons as well, and therefore what we should do. Now, we are living in a world which is changing rapidly and presenting a completely a new set of challenges. While on the one hand, globalism seems to be under threat, thanks to President Trump, on the other hand, new synapses are linking the world like never before. Only yesterday I was talking to an American trade negotiator who I've known for a long time, and he himself was quite sort of critical of the way the Trump administration is dealing with the WTO. I mean, the whole dispute settlement system is being held hostage, and the appointment of the appellate body members is not going to take place. I don't know, this might be one reason, Hardeep, when actually, you know, we will have to call a vote in the WTO, which is there in the agreement, except that there is an understanding that you'll follow the convention of consensus, if not unanimity, in dealing with any of these issues. But if push comes to shove, and I and Pascal have written an article on this, which has been carried in this particular, Pascal Lamy, the former DG of the WTO, where we've said that, you know, if a country like US can hold WTO to ransom, then it is time that we moved on without the US. It doesn't mean, I mean, a lot of people think that, you know, you don't have to be inside WTO to be able to trade. You can continue to trade. I mean, China was a big trader before it entered the WTO. But that's another story. Now, a very important thing which Hardeep spoke about is the rising inequality. It's not only within and among nations, but within particularly. And that is one reason why we see a lot of protests happening everywhere. The Yellow Vest movement in France, for example, is a symbol of this kind of protest. Of course, there were catalytic factors for that kind of movement. There is a counter movement as well. Similar kind of things happened. Now, we need, very rightly, Hardeep, as you said, we need balance and more seasoned thinkers, more than ever before, to make sense of the developments happening within and outside our borders. Sanjay Baru is one of those rare scholars of our times who is well placed to do so. An economist, a journalist, a political commentator without any affiliation, and an expert in foreign and strategic affairs, Sanjay's writings and expositions on complex issues related to India and the world not only reflect his gravitas, but also are extremely relevant amongst the changing dynamics. What I feel is that the government should use him more than what they're using him as he stands. His oeuvre of work is a real tour de force. It reflects his thoroughness in pre-science as a commentator. What I'm saying is corroborated by the authors who have contributed to this volume. I spoke about Jagdish Bhagwati. Two former foreign secretaries, and one of them is a minister also now, Jay Shankar and Shyam Saran. Former U.S. ambassador to India, Robert Blackwell, and former DG WTO, Mr. Pascal Lamy, among others. While they've written on topics like globalization, trade, India-U.S. relations, they have also deeply praised Sanjay's analysis of complex issues over the decades. Therefore, on Sanjay's 65th anniversary, we think this first shift is a perfect tribute to his intellectual contribution to the strategic community in India and around the world. And he spoke a bit about some of his friends abroad who have also contributed in SAR. Let me come to the panel discussion. Thank you. I would like to begin with what our former foreign secretary and the current foreign minister, S. Jayashankar, says in his essay in the book. He wrote this essay when he was at Tata Sons. He says, if there is one thing that all of us agree upon, it is that the world is going through both unexpected and unprecedented changes. We've had so many black swans that some of them have turned white. It is important to separate larger trends from immediate events if we are to come to terms with the new reality. I thought that was an excellent quote to contextualize this whole panel discussion. Of course, it gets narrowed into the individual's context. Now, my first question to the panelists is, in the may I request the panelists if they could respond to these questions as sharp as possible, and then we can move on with an interactive debate. In the context of India-US relations under President Trump, how do you separate larger trends from the immediate events? Larger trends from the immediate events. More importantly, what are these larger trends relevant for this relationship? Do we see them last beyond President Trump? Can I begin with Bhashwati?
But I don't want to speak for 10 minutes. But look, first and foremost, I wouldn't worry too much about the personality or the persona or what the president says. It's important he is the chief executive. In my book, I predicted, I don't write that in my book, I predicted his election. I also, almost to the point that we are today, said, this is how I think it will play out, and that's turned out exactly that way. I also said that his own support base is not diminishing, so don't be surprised, he will be a candidate and could win the next election as well. So that's one. So you have to deal with the United States per se. You have to deal with U.S. trade policy. I think the presidency of the 45th POTUS marks a very clearly defined departure from the earlier listing. Many of the systemic things that we took for granted right up till President Obama, he's questioning those. And it's, I mean, it is finding resonance amongst the people who vote in the current circumstances. Okay? That is the important thing. Can you differentiate between the short term and the medium term or long term, if that's your question? Well, I would say do take his tweets into account. But, you know, they're also part of a pattern. And that pattern is quite clearly, I think, insofar as China is concerned, and I think that's a major preoccupation. The facts, as I see it, that not many countries in the world have come to terms with the rise of China or the manner in which it is growing. But the real important thing is that when the Chinese resumed their membership of the multilateral trading system, and this is where I want to be careful, I'm using the word resumed, okay? And they came in as with an entry fee that they paid in the Uruguay round of trade negotiation. The working party which had been established to deal with China's membership of the WTO as part of that thought that it had imposed an entry fee. In retrospect, what is very clear to me, and I'm speaking as a, in my personal capacity, because by the way, one of you listed my responsibilities in terms of urban affairs, civil aviation, but I'm also in the Ministry of Commerce and Industry. You see that? Good, I missed it. But so what I'm going to say is in my... I'm making a very basic point that, look, today the Chinese should feel very reassured themselves. The rest of the world readmitted them into the multilateral trading system because they were salivating at the prospect of selling to a large market. But what happened is that the Chinese also have that many number of producers. And I think what the Chinese have been able to do, whether it was a failure of the disciplines, that's why I'm speaking in my personal capacity. Look, in a system where data is not readily available, a system which is opaque, a lot of people are complaining that you don't know where a state subsidy might end and an enterprise level dumping action may start. Now, those are the things you have to deal with. But the President of the United States has decided, whether you like it or not, that he is going to rework that relationship. Now, for us, I think there are opportunities, but the small to long term, I think we should tighten our seat belts and get used to the idea that you have the two largest economies in the world flexing their muscles and wanting to reorder the world. I don't think it makes any sense for us to align with one against the other. If the developing country, status is going to be opened up, for instance, etc., we need to drive home the point that it's not just attack. You see, you are a $2.89 trillion economy, but you have very low per capita income, and you also must drive home the point that you have more poor people in India than all the least developed countries of the world put together. So we have a developmental challenge, which is not something that the Western liberal thinker realizes. And unless you deliver goods and services to that section of our country, I'm afraid you will not be able to hold your own in the international system.
Thank you. Parshvati?
I think it was good that we heard Hardeep first. I'd like to give my perspective, moving away from trade issues, to say that, first of all, as far as U.S. is concerned, it's a multi-layered relationship that India has. And we should make a distinction between just looking at United States from what Trump tweets and says to what is actually happening. Let me begin with the most recent incident, which was of Trump and Imran Khan and the furor in India, which I commented on television on 2-3 channels. The issue is that, first of all, it is very important to see the context in which Trump made these statements. And as Hardeep said, there is a pattern which emerges from his tweets and from his pronouncements. One of them is that he has consistently questioned the rise of China. He has consistently questioned some of the things which his predecessor took for granted, whether it was the TPP, the climate change, or the Iran deal. On the other hand, he's made a great effort to move towards North Korea. And then there was this whole thing with Imran Khan, where obviously President Trump's desire to be a deal maker maybe overtook his pragmatism. But that does not mean that there is not that the basic parameters of the relationship that India has with US have been undermined. In fact, on to the contrary. For instance, if President Trump is trying to thwart China's rise economically, well, I think that that is good for India. If President Trump is trying to curb Pakistani terrorism, it's good for India. If President Trump does not have a good perspective on what India should do in Afghanistan, well, we should work on it from behind. We don't know whether maybe the American strategic community doesn't agree with him. So I would say, therefore, in short, that actually President Trump has been spot on a lot of things. Which again shows the trend from his tweets, whether it is, for instance, to take Brexit or Boris Johnson. He was spot on when he told Theresa May that you have not been able to get a good deal for UK. He was right on that. He was right also on the fact that ultimately Johnson would become UK PM. So I think that from an Indian context, we should not put too much of emphasis on Trump's immediate day-to-day tweets or his immediate meetings with various world leaders. We should try to push for what is good for India, and from my perspective, what is good for India is to strengthen this strategic partnership, because it was actually United States that brought us out of our nuclear isolation. And on trade, yes, I agree with Hardeep. Hardeep had written an article when he was not a minister, where he had said that when trade negotiations go wrong, you should sack the trade negotiator, but not move away from the trade agreement. And Hardeep was spot on. That's what we have to do. We have to get a good trade deal for ourselves. If in the process we have to change the negotiator, we change the negotiator.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Suhasini, the question again, let me repeat what Jayashankar has posed in the book, is it is important to separate larger trends from more immediate events if we are to come to terms with the new reality. Now, what I do hear from my American friends quite often is don't blame the U.S. for it. Blame the Trump administration. There is a nuanced difference. I mean, there's a very large number of people there who do not agree with Trump. So, over to you.
I think that attitude, which I see very often in India as well, is disrespectful to a relationship with a country. For anyone to assume that we should somehow disregard what Mr. Trump says, simply because we think he's foolish or says something which is patently false, would be to not understand the nature of what we are confronted with. And I think it disrespects the relationship and also hampers our own ability to do it. I'll be very basic over here and say I think in India we are sometimes afflicted with the all is well problem. That we just want to say, but all is well. Eventually, it doesn't matter what he's saying. It doesn't matter what he's doing because all is well. At the same time, as Mr. Puri pointed out, Mr. Trump might return for another 4 years when he finishes that term. America might not be the country that we, in our minds, have conjured over the last decade or so. So, to start with, I really should make the point that I'm very, very honored to be here and to be invited to speak because some of the formative conversations I've had when thinking about geoeconomics have been with Dr. Baru, as we discussed literally on a day-by-day basis the progress of the nuclear deal. I can tell you now, I'm not sure I'm giving anything away, that the one person who told me from the very beginning that the nuclear deal would go through was Dr. Baru. I won't tell you who the other person was, but it was on the other side of the deal. But the truth was that he had that understanding that India had changed, that America was looking for something, and that we must therefore build this friendship on that basis. With all due respect to all the ambassadors, and I see several distinguished ambassadors here, good friendships are not made from diplomacy. They're made from honesty. When the U.S. decides to withdraw India's GSP status after 30-odd years, our response to that was, all is well. It doesn't matter. Let me tell you, the response to our response in Washington was one of deep disappointment. Because they said, if you don't understand that we are doing something because we are upset about something, you're essentially not understanding the problem to begin with. So in our hurry or haste or wishful thinking to say all is in fact well between India and the US, and this is a short-term problem, it's a Trump-related problem, I think we need to look at the larger consequences of looking away from the actual relationship. We all know, I can list out for you all the great things in the India-US relationship, how the military ties have increased, how trade is growing year on year, how more Indians are going to the U.S. even if it's at a lowered rate. And on the world stage, we stand together, whether it's on terrorism, whether it's on the Indo-Pacific, on countering China's hegemony and the BRI. But I think we cannot look away from the very philosophical differences that we at present have. Mr. Puri just now referred to that moment in 1992 where he actually picked up the phone and told someone on the other side in Washington what he thought of what an undersecretary had said. Today we stand at a position where the President of the United States has said exactly the same thing. In fact, he has said more. He's even accused our Prime Minister of saying things falsely. What is our response to that? Is our response simply, as the Ministry of External Affairs has said, to move on? I think these are the questions we must ask in the short term versus the long term.
Hari wants to say, but I just mentioned in a little humor, when all is well, I'm reminded of all is well from Three Idiots.
We won't say the word. No, so actually, I just wanted to come in very briefly because I have to rush for a meeting. Don't take the Ministry of External Affairs too seriously. No, because hold on, there's a reason for that. Very often, I've spent 40 happy years there, and a public position that you take may not accurately reflect what the way you feel and what message you convey. That's the first point I want to make. Insofar as the GSP withdrawal, look, the GSP scheme was introduced, as far as I can remember, in the early 70s. It was a non-contractual, unilateral scheme of concessions which you give to developing countries. The American argument all along has been, hey, wait a minute, this was designed for the poorest of the poor. It wasn't designed for countries which are a $3 trillion economy and $5 trillion. That's a separate issue. How you react to the GSP scheme, and I am speaking in my personal capacity, not as a Minister of State for Commerce, is a very different issue. But I don't think any purpose is served. And I don't think the American negotiators you are talking to are being entirely candid with you. You know, in diplomacy, very often you take a step, I take a step, etc. You bring it to a point. You want to ask me where the U.S.-China trade thing is going to end up? want my views? In a deal. Make no mistake, at the end of the day, the President of the United States is a deal maker. I have met him on a number of occasions. I used to live in one of the Trump Tower buildings and I was meeting every year and he would ask me the same question. How are you, Mr. Singh? Are you enjoying living in this building? I have written in my book, I did not think at that point of time he would be the President of the United States. I did not think so, but that's more a reflection on me rather than his, great and meteoric success. Look, reactions are given because those are what you need to tell the world, okay? How you are reacting, whether you're using that as part of the negotiation, whether it's moving towards a settlement, etc., that is a separate issue. One of the good things we've learned, and I think this government in particular, we don't negotiate through the press anymore. Thank God. That is why the press today is starved of what the inside story, story of what the real solid stuff in this relation. I mean, the resumption of flights on Pakistani airspace, it was taken, nobody had a clue also. But were there anything that preceded it? What was the discussion, etc.? So I'm just making a point that insofar as President Trump is concerned, my position, lest I be misunderstood, is of course you have to, what he tweets, look at it. But it's also a pointer to where he is going. Now, in certain parts of the system, and it's all out in the open, he's able to carry the American system with him. On climate, there has been a disruption, there has been a derailment, etc. But at the end of the day, I would, in terms of policy formulation on our side, try to work it out in such a way that what he and the system are saying, you have to deal with that and we respond. I personally think we're doing very well. And it's not all is well. All is well is a trying to papering over. But at the end of the day, I mean, look at the hullabaloo that we were subjected to 2 years ago on the H-1B visas. You remember, ye curtail ho raha, ye ho raha. You know, the power lobby start, they think, today what has happened on that issue? At the end of the day, there is nothing that succeeds like success. And I think you have to engage him. He will provoke you. Not you means India, but anyone. He will provoke. He will try and get a deal done. I mean, he's capable of going and selling, snow to the Eskimos. So I'm just going to leave on that. It's going to be a fascinating discussion, but I wish I had more time. Thank you, Sanjay. Thank you. I will leave my meeting and start.
Thank you. Thank you, Hardeep. Thank you very much. Let me come to Sanjay on this question. You know what? I think both of you did not sort of really pin down the fact that will it become an embedded policy in U.S. thinking on a long-term basis, what Trump has done or not done?
Well, you know, I would urge all of you to read Jayashankar's, the foreign minister's chapter in this book. It was written when he was with the Tata Group before he became a minister. But he allowed the chapter to be published. So it is very much his personal thinking, not as the minister of the government. But I think there are a couple of sentences there which are very significant. One, he does say somewhere in the chapter that the United States, by revisiting its approach to engaging the world, is driving changes that were inconceivable just 3 years ago. And then later on, he says, the biggest change, the biggest change is the emergence of American nationalism on the global arena after 8 decades. I just read out these two sentences, but the rest of the chapter is a very fine essay on the fundamental changes happening in America's approach to the world. And I think it's extremely important for us in India to understand this. It's a complete waste of time to be looking at Trump's tweets and imagining that American policy over the next decade or two, whether it's going to reflect those tweets or not reflect those tweets. I don't think there is any real serious difference between the Republicans and the Democrats or within the Republicans on the way America should deal with the rise of China and with its own decline. There is now considerable literature on this issue of how America sees its own decline and how it sees China's rise. Lots of books have been written. There's a chapter in this book by my friend Bob Blackwell, who used to be ambassador here. And Bob has written an excellent book called War by Other Means on geoeconomics. In fact, it's a fascinating book. And I refer you to another book by Edward Luttwak on the rise of China and the logic of conflict. If you look at all of this writing by influential people in the United States, the U.S. is dealing with a changing world. And a significant dimension of that change in U.S. attitude towards the world is to, in fact, challenge its own friends. I just got a forward from TCA sitting at the back, Trump's latest tweet, where he has taking on President Macron. The French have imposed taxes on American software companies. And Trump has just tweeted saying, we will impose retaliatory tax on French wine. And then the tweet ends with a statement, American wine is better than French wine. You know, I mean, Trump is taking on anyone who takes him on. In other words, the United States is fighting the Japanese. We saw Trump's visit to Japan. The United States has basically no regard any longer for the European Union. It's taking on Germany. It's, of course, taking on the Russians and the Chinese. And why will it not take us on policy issues which do not suit them? That's the world we are entering. So it's going to be a challenging world. I'm not fully convinced with Mr. Puri's argument that there will be a deal between China and the United States. There could be a deal, but I would not say there will be a deal. Because the logic of what the United States is doing, as I've argued in my own writings in the last 2-3 years, is the geoeconomic containment of China. Just as the United States undertook the geopolitical containment of the Soviet Union, it is today, in fact, over the last couple of years, and I've written this about 2 years back, it has launched what I would call the geoeconomic containment of China. And that geoeconomic containment of China is aimed at ensuring that Chinese growth tapers off. And Chinese growth is beginning to taper off. And the U.S. will not relent till China's growth rate comes down to 2 to 3% a year. It will push and push and push and push till China's economy slows down to the point where there are social consequences and political consequences at home. That is the way I look at the years ahead. So they are going to be extremely challenging times. Don't waste your time on the short term. Don't waste your time looking at what Trump will say in the run-up to the next elections, which he has to win. And he may say all kinds of bizarre things. I think the challenge is over the next decade. And therefore, the premises on which our relationship, whether with the United States or with the developed countries, was based over the last 25 years, ever since we had liberalized in 1991, there was a strategy from 91 to 2014. That strategy, in my view, is no longer relevant. We have to rethink our relationship with the United States.
Sanjaya, can I ask you a question on this particular point? What I perceive is, since a long time, the pendulum is shifting from the West to the East. The rise of China, including India and many other countries as well. That does cause indigestion, which is what I could see in the trade area where we work very closely. The Cancun collapse, if you remember, Sanjay, when you were the editor and I, Vivek, and Rohit Bansal, three of us were writing on a daily basis. There was, you know, the old quad was replaced by a new quad, which included India and Brazil. And Canada and Japan were thrown out, U.S. and European Union states. And that is the point when I realized that there is this indigestion which is happening. And subsequently, WTO has never been able to come to an even keel. And we continue to face problems today. Now, in this context, what you have spoken about, U.S. Trying to bring down China on its knees, how would you look at the Shanghai Cooperation Organization or that kind of arrangement between India, Russia and China as a counter. Can that act as a counter?
You know, frankly, we should not get into any of these traps. I mean, the world is full of clubs. I keep telling people, it's like, you know, if you live in Delhi long enough, you want to be a member of IIC, you want to be a member of India Habitat, and once you got that, you want to get into Delhi Gymkhana, then you want to get Delhi Golf Club. This aspirational, you know, club membership mentality has become a disease for global leaders. And we seek membership of all kinds of clubs without really understanding whether we need them or not. So, you know, SCO, for example, is one of those clubs which we wanted to be there. Pakistan was there. So many others are there. I don't know, understand what you'll get out of it. The only relevant club, as far as I'm concerned, is the East Asian, you know, the East Asian process, the ASEAN Plus group.
RCEP
is in the making, but the existing one is the ASEAN Plus 6. And that is, I believe, actually, the locus of the Indo-Pacific, etc. That's a useful group to be. BRICS, SCO, wagera, wagera, these are all waste of time. You have time, you go. Non-aligned movement, we stopped even going there.
Thanks.
But I think for India, there is no option but to deal with each of the major powers individually and independently of each other. That is what I understand by the term multi-alignment, which has been used by Jai Shankar and others, that we are now moving from non-alignment to multi-alignment, which essentially means the India-Russia relationship.
You preempted my question too.
Yeah.
But anyway, let me, Shakti, on the first question.
Yeah, on the first question and combining...
No,
I don't think so. I'll tell you why. I want to combine what Hardeep and Sanjay both alluded. I'll go back to the readout of that day, Trump's famous tweet. The White House readout doesn't mention this business of negotiation at all. Going further, Trump mentioned in front of TV cameras that we've been paying you guys billions of dollars and no prime minister before you have acted in our interest. They have been subversive. But now with you are there, you're cooperating with us and I want you to continue cooperating with you. In other words, that's a fairly strong exposure of Pakistan's position, which made Imran Khan tell the USIP, the United States Institute of Peace, that we have never mentioned it, but actually we helped, the ISI helped the Americans catch Osama bin Laden. Something which is completely contrary to what Pakistan has been saying throughout, that they were not aware and nothing is happening. Afridi is still in jail. I think Trump's method of tweeting, there is a method to it. We have to, yes, it's not always well, but we must get understand it. So therefore he's also providing cover in that sense to Imran Khan. Fine. You can go back and say America's agreed to negotiate on Kashmir with India. Give me cover, but deliver on Afghanistan, deliver on peace there. So that, I mean, just taken out of context can be, because Trump tweets every day, and I said there is a method to it, but if the US government itself in its statement on the talks does not mention negotiation, it obviously means that they have taken it in the context of what it is, and they are not looking beyond it. Now, should countries be negotiating in this manner? We really don't know. It hasn't happened before, but if it is happening now, it is something that America's best friends, Japan and the United Kingdom, are also getting used to it. It's not the best way to go about it, but I don't think we can wish it away and hope that things will turn out differently.
Thank you, Shakti. With that, let me come to the second interesting point, which Sanjay was nearly preempted me. Raja Mohan, another very famous strategic thinker of India, now in Singapore, in his essay in this book has argued that Prime Minister Modi's biggest contribution to Indian foreign policy was to get the Indian establishment past the fixation with non-alignment. The terms strategic autonomy and non-alignment barely figured in Modi's articulation of India's worldview. He further argues that the notion of strategic autonomy ends up as a do-nothing strategy that fails to take full advantage of the partnership with the United States. Frederick Greer, another senior fellow at Carnegie's South Asia program, who, on the other hand, argues that India's cherished strategic autonomy, which for a long time acted as an obstacle to any significant rapprochement with the U.S., may become a condition for the development of the partnership. Who would like to take this question? Suhasini?
I should add that strategic autonomy came back into the Prime Minister's lexicon about a year ago when he spoke at the Shangri-La Dialogue, making it very clear that this is not a done deal. I'm not just sliding in one direction or the other. When it comes to multi-alignment, it presupposes the idea that somebody is giving you that choice. Multi-alignment means that everybody involved in the alignment is saying to you, that's okay with us. What happens in a world where the United States says, no, in fact, if you are going to buy, say, military hardware from Russia, you are not going to be able to deal with us on a whole battery of hardware, simply because we have interoperability now, we have new technical systems, we can't go ahead with you. What do you do in a world where the United States tells you that if you were to do trials with a Chinese company, say Huawei, you will not be able to enter into security arrangements with us on telecommunications? This is something the US has already told Germany. We're waiting to find out if they say the same to us publicly. The question is, are these now options? Multi-alignment was a great idea. I called it non-alignment 5.0, because if you looked at non-alignment as it was conceived as a way of India batting way above its size. The idea of it being the voice for the voiceless, the idea of it not taking sides in a Cold War. It was certainly supplanted, especially after our own friendship treaty with the Soviets. It was supplanted again in the 90s, and Dr. Badu has written so much about this, the idea that geoeconomics took over, that economically we could move away from this whole concept of not being allied one way or the other. So we've had several iterations or several new versions of non-alignment. Maybe multi-alignment is NAM 5.0. But I'm just saying that now that we are looking at it with a new prism, the black swans that have turned into white swans and President Trump coming into the fore, maybe this is not going to be a choice. What we're told again and again by thinkers in Washington that the a la carte option is no longer on the menu. What you're getting is either a buffet on this side or a buffet on that side.
Thank you. May I turn to Shakti on this?
USA is obviously... That's what I'm saying, sir. USA is easily the biggest economy in the world, the biggest power in the world. Since 1990, Paul Kennedy has been predicting his demise. It hasn't happened. It won't happen again. It is in a position, rightly, wrongly, fairly, unfairly, to impose its terms. It has done so with literally every country in the last many years. So I think when you're dealing with a behemoth like the USA, things are not the same as dealing with other countries. Whether it is for China, whether it is for Russia, which is the most important country for China? It is the USA, period. So therefore, America's ability to therefore stamp on you as an 800-pound gorilla will always be there. No world has ever been a world where everybody is equal. Sovereign equality is fine. One vote, United Nations is fine. But the reality is that big powers will always be in a position to give you choices that you really can't say no to. And there the trick comes in. The more you grow economically, the greater are your options available to you to negotiate with the USA. If you were today a $500 billion economy, nobody would look at you. But if you were today already a $6 trillion economy, the options open to you are far greater then. So it is a give and take situation.
Including inviting hostility.
Absolutely. I mean, let's be very clear. When Russia walks into Crimea, does anybody do anything about it? The answer is no. When Russia walks into East Ukraine with tanks and anti-missile equipment, which no militia has, did the world say anything? The answer is no. Half of Georgia is still under Russian control. Full stop. Big powers have the ability to trample on others in the real world. Ideally, they should not have, but the ideal world does not. After all, Sanandati Dattar's book on Kashmir, on Sikkim, is called Smash and Grab. It's about the Indian state.
Thank you. Thank you. Of course. I'll come to you. Now, Shastri, can I ask you a very specific question if you can answer to that? One does, there's undoubtedly people could, touch on various peripheral and flanking issues, but, in this kind of contrarian context, how do you view, what type of transactions India and U.S. can undertake which will neither undermine strategic economy and comes in the way of two countries building a more robust relationship.
Is that addressed to me?
Yeah.
I first wanted to...
addressed to Sanjay also.
Okay. I wanted to first comment on your earlier question about alignment, non-alignment and alignment.
Yeah.
To say that the way I understood what Prime Minister Modi said in Shangri-La, which was also clarified by Foreign Secretary Vijay Gokhale a little earlier, was that India is moving away from non-alignment to issue-based alignment. And I think that is a very important point. When we talk about issue-based alignment, it means that, in a way, it's similar to what Suhasini said, but in a slightly different nuance, is that we are now looking at the world order and at issues and deciding on that regardless of what could have been a non-aligned principle, because at some point, the non-aligned movement was dragging us down because we had moved away from non-alignment economically and politically. And the non-aligned movement was going in one direction, we were going in the other. So therefore, I would say...
Come to my question. I mean, how do you... You know, in the sense that, you know, what type of transactions India and US can undertake which can neither undermine strategic autonomy nor come in the way of the two countries building a more robust relationship? It's a little complex question.
Well, I believe that the way we are engaging with the United States is in a multi-layered manner. I agree with what Hardeep said, that we don't have to be obsessed by President Trump's tweets, except that they lead us in a direction where we see United States going. So I would like to add that the fact that President Trump has come to power and may win the next election actually demonstrates that perhaps we are now dealing with a United States that is fundamentally changing, with a United States that is no longer the champion of the Western liberal order that emerged from World War II, and that therefore we too need to make those changes, if we wish to deal with a very different kind of United States. That's my first response to your question. And if you would permit me to conclude, what I am saying here is...
No, don't conclude now. There are other
questions. No, on the strategic autonomy part of it. A lot is said about strategic autonomy by strategic pundits. But in reality, what is this strategic autonomy? It is our freedom to choose where we need to go at a particular point of time that is good for us. That's the way I define strategic autonomy. And from that perspective, for instance, what the Americans are doing right now in Afghanistan is not good for India. Their engaging with Taliban is not good for India. The comments that have been made by Trump with Imran Khan, regardless of the... is not good for India. How we deal with that is another issue. But if you ask me, is it good for India, what is happening between US and Afghanistan and engaging the Taliban? No, it is absolutely fundamentally detrimental to India's policy in Afghanistan, where we needed our strategic autonomy, where in fact Pakistan's strategic autonomy goals are being gained at our expense. So
I agree with you, Sanjay. The question is... how do you read these contrarian views? and what type of transactions India and US can undertake which neither undermines strategic autonomy nor comes in the way of the two countries building a more robust relationship? We heard about this,
I think, as Basuji said.
And, buying the Russian missiles and so on. I mean, these are all...
That will be a good test.
Defense.
That will be a good test. As of now, we are on course... on S-400, I don't think we have indicated any...
No, this is an example.
No, it's not just an example. It is a very important test case. Whether we continue with this defense relationship with Russia or not, that is where strategic autonomy comes in.
Yeah.
India will remain an important customer for Russian defense equipment. I don't see India ending that. India is buying more from the United States. India can never become only dependent on the United States. Never.
Or any country.
Well, we were only dependent on Russia at one point. We have diversified. We are now increasingly buying from several other countries, which is exactly the direction we should be going in. Now, if we stop buying from Russia, that would be the end of strategic autonomy in my view. But if we stop buying from, Or rather, if we decide this year we will not buy oil from Iran, and next year we may buy, that is different. Because with Iran, if you see the history of oil purchases, there are years in which we have bought, there are years in which we have not bought, there are years in which our purchases have gone up, there are years in which they have gone down, and it's a relationship that keeps going up and down, and I think that will continue. But stopping consumption, purchase of defense. So, beyond that, the world, as I said, the world, as I see emerging, is one in which we have to deal with everybody. We will certainly have to improve our relations with China. There's no option for India but to improve relations with China. To assume that India-China relations will become worse would be a wrong assumption. Yeah. And therefore, Indian policy must be constructed on the basis of a hope that the relationship can actually improve despite whatever differences we have. Similarly, we have to sustain a relationship with Russia. We have to sustain and strengthen our relationship with the United States, despite whatever the U.S. may do in its own interests. Because let us not forget that every country acts only in its own interests.
Yeah, exactly. You know,
sometimes we tend to think that when others take decisions, they're taking it against us. No. It is not the only country in the world which actually acts against India is Pakistan. Honestly, I do not see any other country acting against India.
Pakistan is an award.
But every other country is acting in its own national interest based on its perception of its security calculus, based in its perception of emerging world, etc. And therefore, the U.S. is doing what it thinks it's good for the U.S. Some of that will hurt us.
Sanjay, interestingly, Turkey being a NATO ally is also buying the same missile defense system. Even they are going ahead. So that gives us a very clear...
Let us not...
Yeah.
Right. No, but we have also paid.
No, but
Before Katsa. Okay, fine.
But Pradeep, India need not take courage from Turkey.
One minute. We are also being, there is a bill being passed in the U.S. Parliament which talks about giving India the same status as a NATO ally.
We don't need
for defense. That is what they are doing for their own benefit.
No, I don't see. I don't see that happening. But in any case, we don't need it. I don't see any reason why we should be classified as a NATO ally or a near NATO ally. We are an independent power.
Sure.
You know, as Suhasini said, the Turkey thing came before the CATSA. But more than that, Turkey being a NATO, an important member of the alliance, what the argument that the Americans are making is that they cannot allow their very advanced fighter aircraft, etc., to be exposed to Russian snooping through the S-400. That argument does not apply to India at all. And in fact, earlier when we were negotiating S-400, we had got indications from the U.S., including from a series of tweets, in fact. I also follow the tweets of Trump. It's quite an interesting exercise.
You are
also a fan? Yes. Not a fan. I enjoy reading his tweets sometimes. He had given an indication earlier that they may give us a waiver. In fact, at one point, we were quite confident, even the Indian media was confident, we were getting a waiver. So, again, on S-400, I agree with Sanjay that it's a test case. Why? That are they going to give us that waiver or not? We are not a NATO ally. This NATO thing is being has been brought up, in my opinion, in order to use the same argument against us for the waiver as they've done with Turkey. That's the point I want to make.
My question was larger rather than granular. Instead, I just took that as an example rather than as something which we need to go. That it doesn't matter whether it is grandfathered or not. You are still. Do they follow any logic or reason? They don't. I beg your pardon. But anyway, let me come.
Could I answer your question?
Can I move on, Suhasini? The context of question three is a plain, simple reading of the Indo-Pacific Strategy report unveiled by the U.S. recently in June indicates that larger security alliances are at the heart of the Indo-Pacific Strategy. Now, the question is to the panel, is the Indo-Pacific conversation increasingly being hijacked by security dimension? How do you read a case for building stronger economies in the region through a shared collaboration? After all, without a strong economy, there is no strong security. What is the meeting point? Secondly, security alliance against whom? We all know whom. The official US position seems to indicate that Indo-Pacific strategy is geared towards creating alliances against countries like Russia and China. How should India deal with this situation? And can we be more more policy oriented rather than granular? Otherwise we lose the point.
That's a very vital issue that you've raised. In my opinion, the Indo-Pacific strategy of the Americans, to which we are gradually coming on board, has a greater security dimension than an economic dimension. It is intended to keep the Indian Ocean free from the rise of China. From that perspective alone that I'm addressing, that if it is to keep the Indian Ocean free, and the Indo-Pacific region free, which is a region of vital importance for us, yes, we do have a valid national interest in going along with Americans. Where we are cautious and where our Prime Minister, we could not attend the last Shangri-La because it clashed with the swearing-in of Prime Minister Modi 2.0, but we have shared our views and we've made it clear that we do not share the American position of overtly saying that the Indo-Pacific and the Quad is directed against a particular country. But if you look clearly at what the signals we've given, it's clear that we share their preoccupation that we want to keep the Indo-Pacific free. As far as the economic aspect is concerned, that is taken care of, as Sanjay said earlier, in the ASEAN Plus dialogue, because that actually safeguards our economic interests. So I actually see the Indo-Pacific as a great way for India to collaborate with the United States and to help in keeping the Indo-Pacific free of Chinese influence, which is actually, in my view, we need to move away from our obsession with Pakistan and recognize that one of our greatest threats actually emanates not from Pakistan, but from China.
That is the reason why India has adopted that Act East policy. And, you know, the whole discussion today is now East and South Asia.
But that is part. That is part
Can
of the fact.
Sanjay.
Sorry, Sanjay.
Because she raised this issue about what you had raised, the ASEAN Plus. Now, in the terms of Indo-Pacific strategy, what do you think are the kind of economic opportunities? Or should only security be the guiding principle?
The ASEAN Plus 6 focus has always been on economics. It's a regional economic cooperation building effort. And the logical conclusion of ASEAN Plus 6 is RCEP, though it's minus US, because US is part of ASEAN Plus 6. US is not in RCEP. So RCEP is ASEAN Plus 6 minus US, which is why the US is objecting. Anyway, Indo-Pacific as a concept has always been related to security. It was not visualized as an economic construct. The first statement conceptualizing the concept of Indo-Pacific was made by Shinzo Abe in August 2007 here in Delhi when he addressed the Indian Parliament, where he spoke of the confluence of the two seas. So the initiative originally came from Japan, because the Japanese are worried about Chinese activity in South China Sea, China's rise, and Chinese attempt at containment of Japan. And therefore, the Japanese were reaching out to India. And in reaching out to India, talked about the confluence of the two oceans, Pacific and Indian. And Abe promoted the idea. We were cautious in reacting to Abe. The only public statement made by Manmohan Singh endorsing the idea of Indo-Pacific was made in September 2013, a few months before the end of his second term, when he addressed a gathering in Tokyo. That too, it was not an official meeting. It was a gathering of businessmen and think tanks, etc. But otherwise, the Indian Prime Minister till 2018 did not use the term Indo-Pacific. The first time the Indian Prime Minister talked about Indo-Pacific was when Prime Minister Modi went to Shangri-La dialogue in June 2018. But in between August 2007 when Abe spoke about it and June 2018 when Modi spoke about it, you had a famous speech by Hillary Clinton in Chennai when she came to India in 2000 2009 or 2010. She went all the way to Chennai because it's facing the east, Bay of Bengal, and spoke about the Indo-Pacific. Now, you have a Japanese view of the Indo-Pacific, you have a Indian view of the Indo-Pacific, and you have an American view of the Indo-Pacific. There are other views of the Indo-Pacific. Now the Indonesians are talking about it, the Singaporeans are talking about it, but there is no one view of the Indo-Pacific. So in fact, if you look at the academic literature, the remarks are always, what is this? It's like that elephant and the seven blind men. Each one has his own view of what this Indo-Pacific is.
To be honest, to continue what the Prime Minister said at Shangri-La Dialogue, he made it very clear. He said the Indo-Pacific is only a geographical construct. It cannot be a strategic concept. Now, whether India has changed its mind in the one year since the Prime Minister articulated it, I don't know.
Suhasini, 1 minute. Can I ask you a question, an interruption here? What Sanjay said, and I would like to divert a bit from what he said. And it's work that we are actually doing, empirical work, so we come with that kind of experience, that connectivity is very important. And that means infrastructure, and that means economics. You cannot ignore the economic dimension of security. Unless we are able to connect, like we are building this highway in Burma, Thailand, etc., and it will go on and on.
So just to come to that, I do want to also make the point that some of the confusion is not between the six blind men. It's within each of those countries themselves. If we have joined the SCO, which has a security dimension to it, can we conceivably see our army taking part in exercises that encompass Russia and China and be part of the Indo-Pacific, where our Navy is taking part in something along with Japan, Australia? So that kind of, I'm not trying to belittle it, I'm just saying that there is a confusion within our own strategic concept of where we really want to go with this. And until we clear that confusion and move away from this idea of pleasing all, we will have to live with the confusion, if you like. When it comes to connectivity, you're absolutely right. I think the Indo-Pacific has always been conceptualizes of two parts, holding the waters free for navigation and of offering a counter or offering an alternative to the world when it comes to connectivity, because we are now confronted with the Chinese dream of the Belt and Road Initiative. How do we deal with it? Are there places we can cooperate with the BRI? India has made it clear, not for the moment. So therefore, we will have to build an alternate structure to it. I think it was the Thai ambassador who said some time ago, but the road doesn't really know who is going on it. Once the road is built that goes through Thailand, are you going to say that Chinese trucks can't go on it and the Indian truck can't go on a BRI-built highway or can't use a waterway that's been constructed under one? You can't. So therefore, we are facing that situation where we're going to have to ask those questions. Are we only opposed to BRI in its idea, in which case are there ways in which we can deal with it? And are we in a position to actually provide the alternative? My question about both the Maldives and Sri Lanka has been the same. And I fear that we are going to face the same problem in the Maldives that we faced in Sri Lanka, which is after changing of governments, people coming in who say we are not going to allow the Chinese free run, you've actually gone back into the system because you have not been given alternative sources of financing. It's not because people are in debt or because people are in a debt trap, but because the alternates have not yet been built.
Thank you. Just to take off from where Swasi left off, some of the problem also arises, the agreement themselves are tailored in a manner that whether the project goes through or not, you have to repay China. Then they say, if I'm paying China, I might as well get the project. But Pradeep, connectivity is important, infrastructure is important. But if you look at the history of economic growth the last 300 years, infrastructure growth has never preceded economic growth. Never. It has facilitated it, no doubt. Most big infrastructures have been built after the economies have become big. That doesn't mean infrastructure is not important. It is, and we have done a fairly good job in our ports, for example. There is no waiting period anymore. Things are changing. But the economic dimensions of Indo-Pacific, Sanjay is right, our interest should be eastwards, right? On RCEP, what is happening? Are you being seen as the
spoiler?
The bull in the China shop?
The fact is, your best friends are saying, get out of your mercantilist mentality. Get into trade as mutually beneficial. Autarchic? No, even mercantilist. I mean, anybody, if I ask you, is exports good? Everybody will raise their hands. If I ask you, are imports good? Nobody will. Excuse me? It can't work that way. Imports are very good. If I didn't have imports, I wouldn't be eating food. My exports, my salary. My imports, the food, the movies, the rental, the car, the holidays. Why don't we take it in that way? But we are have to become a stronger economy. Our links have to be very strong with East Asia, rightly so with ASEAN Plus. And Prime Minister Modi was absolutely right and Shangri-La. We are not looking at containing anybody. At the same time, we want our economic opportunities with China, absolutely. At the same time, we also must recognize that China poses a threat, as Bhaswati said. And therefore, the exercises, or as Sarathi said, the exercises on with the USA, the Malabar exercises, right, will carry on. But yes, we have to decide whether we do Malabar along with exercises in SEO with the Pakistani army. That is something you have to decide.
Nobody mentioned the India-Japan partnership about that economic corridor from, you know, Japan. Nothing is happening, unfortunately, to Africa. And therefore, even in the Indo-Pacific definition, India also looks at the east coast of Africa also as a part of that. But let me come to now, turn to a natural corollary to what we've been discussing is to trade. This is, I'm not talking about the Indo-US relations particularly, the economic dimension of the relationship. While US actions seem to be undermining multilateralism in trade, particularly through the WTO, countries like India and China have a strategic case in preserving that, in the sense that even the joint submission that we've been making at the WTO is for reforms, but not to shut it down. Now, in the essay that I have co-authored with Pascal Lamy in February this year, which is also in this book, we had argued that it is vital to understand the rise of US-led protectionism and how its likely escalation may be countered by reviewing the institutional framework of the WTO. Unfortunately, this has become now a disease. I mean, there are many countries which are, you know, including India. Why blame others? So the question to the panelists is, what are your views on this? We'd also argued that G20 should take up this agenda, but it seems Osaka was not able to achieve much against containing protectionism. How worried should we be? Sanjay, can I start with you?
Oh, we should be worried. Because as I said earlier, you have the world's richest economy becoming increasingly protectionist. That is not good. US has made the WTO virtually dysfunctional by refusing to, you know, empower it administratively with membership of the dispute settlement court, etc., appellate body. So we should be worried. And, this Western protectionism is happening at a time when our trade is, in fact, not growing. So obviously, China is slowing down. The kind of growth we saw in Africa in the last 5 years is also slowing down. So where are the markets? I think there is something I would seriously worry about. And Indian domestic economic policy will have to factor this in, whether we can revive the kind of export growth that we had in the last few years. You can see that already the government's reaction has been defensive by increasing tariffs. This is a defensive response to a difficult external environment. But whether you can sustain this defensive response is also not clear. So the external world is becoming challenging, and it's becoming challenging because the rich are becoming protectionist. And I do now think that the time has come for us to once again revive the old G77 kind of developing country coalition, which in a sense went into the margins, in the era of globalization with rising global trade and rising integration of economies, etc., the old conversation about a new international economic order, all of that we heard in the 90s, right? But after the turn of the century, we've had 10, 15 years of no such conversation. And after 2009 crisis, the West has become insular. The West has become defensive. The West is pursuing policies that are increasing global inequality. So I think the time has come for India to take leadership of the developing world, at least on the economic front. And, G20 has failed in addressing this issue. Japan tried to put it on the agenda at the Osaka summit. The Japanese are also worried. Incidentally, it's no longer just the developing countries. It's all export-oriented economies. All of East Asia is worried. So we have actually new allies now, if we were to revive that platform.
Let me share with you, Sanjay, one insight which has been happening in Geneva. Is, you know, one of the push that the U.S. is making is of getting countries like India, Brazil, and China out of the developing countries definition. You know, the emerging economies, the advanced developing countries. In one manner or the other, they sold it to the Africans also. So Africans are not ready to join India in the debate that we should continue to remain. I mean, Hardeep reminded us again and again that we are one of the world's poorest countries in terms of the number of sheer large number of poor in the country, but though our economy may be $2.89 trillion. And that is what the argument of U.S. is, that if you want to reform WTO, that means you must, the differentiation must happen. And there, Sanjay, we are losing that developing country alliance. They won't even want us to talk about writing a paper on that. Bhashwati.
If I can just make a comment on
sir. Why don't you listen? We've got these expert panelists. Yeah. Thank you very much. Will do.
Q&A.
Okay, would you like to?
Yeah,
1 minute. Would you like to ask your question?
Can I and finish what I'm saying first? Excuse me.
No, can you ask your question?
Yeah, sure.
Sharp, please.
Retired IAS officer in Government of India. I just wanted to say that I wanted a copy of the India-US relation book which has been released today. But this was not available in the counter. Normally in the book release, the
we
book
can talk about it with the organizers.
Yeah, that's fine. What I am to say, sir, we are discussing about...
Mr. Bardhan, can you ask a relevant question?
Yeah, I'm asking a question about Indo-US relations. Okay? Sir, recently we are planned by the Jal Plavan. Bilkul India, everywhere from north to east and east to west, all our states are under the water. And there have been so many unfortunate...
Mr. Bardhan, can you ask a question relevant to India-US context? I think you're going out of context. Please, take your seat.
Died no fault
please,
of...
Please take your seat.
Sir, what I wanted to know... What
please
is
take
the,
your seat, sir. Can you take...
Sir, 1 second to this.
Sir, no, I mean, let the panel continue.
Sir, USA also people have died in the flood. Sir, I want to know what is the lessons we can learn from the advanced country like USA.
Very good question. Yeah.
If I can just go back to the point I was making... which is that, as Sanjay said, we have every reason to be very concerned that the United States is turning away from rule-based multilateralism and trade rules which they themselves had pioneered and which, allowed the world economy, global economy to grow and trade through a rule-based multilateral system. The point I wanted to make was the point you had made, the point that you had made about G77, I would like to share with you because I have been involved in G77 negotiations during my 38-year career as a diplomat, that one of the fundamental problems we had in the G77 is that The G77 consists of three layers of economies, including least developed countries. And even when we were at a lower stage of economic development in the 90s, we had difficulties with the kind of demands that were being made to us as G77, especially when we were chairing, we often chaired G77, by LDCs. This plagued us in the negotiations on climate change. It plagued us on the negotiations, which Sanjay and Suhashni would be very well aware of, within the WTO, etc. And that is why this policy of divide and rule, where they are appealing to the Africans to explain that we are not a developing country anymore, will fall on very fertile ground because of our own inherent problem in accommodating the concerns of, let's say the least developed countries, island states, when we were doing climate change negotiation. They had a completely different set of concerns, different from ours. And if we had accommodated their concerns, we could have lost out economically and politically at home. So this is a very, very large issue which needs to be looked at maybe through another essay or an article, because it's a very, very difficult and tricky issue.
Vasudev, my own experience is only, it only validates what Sanjay said, that every country looks after its self-interest. So, you know, it doesn't matter. So, Ashim?
Just to say, in the present, we are looking at three separate sets of negotiations. And what India decides to do in the next 6 months is really going to define which way forward, because people are running out of patience. We don't have time on our sides to figure out what our worldview is or where we want to ally or which side we want to do what with. The three negotiations are simply the RCEP negotiations, where at least from what I understand, most nations want to have substantial outcomes by November this year. The second is the Indo-US trade negotiations, which may, as Mr. Puri was very optimistic about, end in a deal even for us. But at the moment seem to be stuck on a narrow basket of issues, but stuck very badly on those issues.
No, also stuck on cross-sectoral issues.
Sure. And also philosophical issues, things like, you know, the dairy and vegetarian that we can't really give in on. And the third set of negotiations, which everybody has kind of given up on, but I know that Ambassador Mukherjee was a part of, is the India-EU PTI. Yeah. Why is that important? Because it is part of an alternate vision in which India sees itself as part of a very important collaborations with Europe on one side and the East Asian countries on the other, where we don't have to get into this US-China-Russia game the entire time. If we don't take proactive measures to at least engage in all of these three negotiations, India might see itself cut out, not because of bad bilateral relations, but simply because it is not in the, it's not present in the room. And I think that's something we should worry about, that nobody bears real ill will towards us, except for perhaps the countries mentioned. Nobody wants to cut India out of a deal, and I would posit it's the same with the Afghanistan question. But India has to start taking a stand, and that stand will mean which way we are on economics as well as strategy.
Going back to Sanjay's initial point, USA protectionism is happening at a time when, thanks to the fourth industrial revolution, the USA's comparative advantage in manufacturing has come back to it with a vengeance. So USA is actually now becoming a major producer and exporter of manufactured goods. So your whole export-led model itself becomes questionable now. And in any case, we've not drawn, when China moved up the wages, those industries have moved to Vietnam and Bangladesh and not to India. So it does put limits on options in that sense. And therefore, the ability to, I think Swasi is absolutely spot on. European Union does represent a very, very major chunk. And I don't think we'd be particularly worried about Indians consuming French wine and therefore keeping a very high tariff on French wines. I mean, these are the kinds of issues we're stuck with Europe with. They are fundamental issues also. But wines is one of them. Do we really care how much, what is the cost of French wine in the Indian market? I mean, why should we, you know? So we have to open up our better understanding, because there's no permanent allies in this game anymore. There are no permanent friends anymore. It has to be on each different issues. Who are the people you bandwagon with are those people who share your interest. In this case, the exporting countries share your interest. It also means that you should be able to access really high-end technology, so that you're not left out of the game when it comes to manufacturing. You're not stuck at the lower end of the table.
Thank you. That reminds me that Trump was very keen about us lowering tariffs on Harley Davidson. And Harley Davidson moved its manufacturing to Europe. Giving Trump to Sanjay?
You sell 100 to Harley Davidson a year.
100 only in
Europe.
Okay. We have another 10 minutes to go. So if there are any burning questions, and no statements, please.
When I talked about we did not have a system for banks and financial institutions for risk management. And you were the one who were the first one to report on that. So we do not care what is not there, what can really protect our economy, number one. Number two, you will remember what Mr. Puri said, various things from independence to onward. The point is 2000 year was the most important for India to get what we got. We got more in this particular time from that time now than what we got it from independence. That was the Y2K 2000 year. And thereafter, when I came to you, when you were an advisor to the Prime Minister and you were very encouraging me that we should have something to do with a World BPA Forum. It did not happen. I took it to New York. The point is, what has created the economy for us?
Thank you.
No, Mr. Mehta, let me complete.
Sir, there are others also.
Yes, but I'm just saying something to you.
There are others also. You can come to the question.
One point to you. Question is this. The next scenario for growth is only and only artificial intelligence if we can export. That is what. And I'm telling you today in front of all, I have tools to create in 54 months $5 trillion economy.
Thank you. Thank you very much. No, ये पीछे जो उधर lady है ना बीच में हाँ and please no speeches you know if you can
hello thank you so much so when we talk about India's strategic autonomy I think about the approximately 34% rise in the oil exports from US oil imports from US and the $18 billion defense deal that India and US are planning to lock in the months coming ahead. So I just want to ask, are these measures a response that India is perhaps taking the side of U.S. Sanctionist policies? Or is it a response that India is accepting U.S. strength over its strategic autonomy by questioning its path dependency? Or is it perhaps a third kind of a response?
Thank you.
Thank you.
There's one question here.
Mr. Bose, a short question.
I beg your pardon, no speeches, sir.
No speeches, a very short question. I would like to elicit the view of this very distinguished panel on the what Lincoln called the power of persuasion in Indo-American relations. I will only take a minute more of your time. Years ago, when the Babri Masjid was brought down, Mr. Narasimha Rao called me and said, what do I do? I said, I meet the American ambassador first and persuade him to your point of view. And it worked. So the power of persuasion. If there are hiccups with Trump, use the words of Lincoln. Simple, unassuming persuasion, which, like a drop of honey, catches the human mind.
Yeah.
You see. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Can I, Bhashwati, for your last words?
Well, I first of all wanted to thank you for including me in the panel and to say that for me, the biggest takeaway is that we've been able to identify what are the friction areas, and we've been able to take away some important takeaways. For me, the most important takeaway is the whole issue of in the Indo-Pacific on one hand, and the whole issue of WTO and the problems that we are facing in not being able to get into negotiated trade agreements multilaterally with big economic countries. I think these are some of the very important issues that India needs to look at if you're going to move on. I completely agree with Suhashini that the three issues that she identified, particularly the latter one, the BTIA, which has been stuck since 2007, actually demonstrates that there is something lacking here, that we are not able to move ahead in any trade arrangement with any trade bloc. So there must be also something ailing within us that we need to address. Thank you.
Thank you. Suhashini?
just to address the young lady's question, I think you're absolutely right to point out each one of them. Some of them are just purely commercial decisions that have been dressed up as our way of balancing the trade deficit or the trade relations between India and the US. But I think it is necessary to look at that entire basket. We came very close in November to a trade deal which would have included a lot of the issues, not just the direct trade issues between India and the US. Is it possible to go ahead on those? There are some issues which we have made into an issue of strategic autonomy, which I don't think need to be, which is the Harley-Davidson issue. Eventually, it's 300 motor bicycles. They're not going to make the US rich, and they're certainly not going to impoverish us. We need to pick our battles in all of these. And I think the idea that we allow a certain a downslide in relations to go unchecked is actually the most dangerous one.
Very well put.
I think I agree with Suhasini. The fact is we have a trade surplus with the U.S. and we have been scratching our head for a long time to understand how we can remedy a little bit of that. I mean, I do think that we should continue to have a trade surplus with a developed country, but since they have been complaining, you look at what you can do. So defense purchases, oil purchases, Harley-Davidson, these are all ways in which you can show to the Americans that, look, we are also buying from you. So I don't think it's something that I would worry about too much.
And finally, as we all discussed, ultimately every country acts as its own interest. Of course you make mistakes. That's not the issue. And you want to get the best for yourself. So if you're buying good, high-end defense equipment from the United States, you're also buying it because you need it. So, one should not see everything as a simple Mujhe Kya Mila kind of situation. You are looking at yourself, and therefore you're trying to do. And therefore, what should the USA do for me all the time? And as Sanjay said, we are possibly running the second highest trade, America's second largest trade deficit now is literally with India, once trade in the goods and services are included. So, we complain about the Chinese deficit. We never talk about the surplus with the USA.
No, I think we should barter the deficit with China with the surplus of the U.S.
and
balance it out. Thank you very much, Abhishek.
Well, thank you to our esteemed panelists. It's been very, very thank you. Thank you very much for coming here, taking your time out. And thank you to our chief guest also who's not here, but as noted economist Jagdish Bhagwati said, that he's perhaps a very apt person to have released this book, him being a diplomat, him being somebody who knows world affairs very, very closely and very nicely, and also somebody who has a very good sense on trade issues, something that we are confronting right now. On that note, let me just officially close this event today. My last note is that on the panel, there are two of my bosses, my mentors. Suhasini, who, when I was a rookie journalist in CNN, IBN, literally handheld and showed me the world of journalism. So thank you, Suhasini, very much. Mr. Mehta, a mentor par excellence again. And about Dr. Baru, I've been reading your writings for quite some time. My first interaction with him happened when we co-edited a book, a fest script, last year for Mr. Mehta. And since then, before that, it was like Dronacharya Klavya story. I was watching you on social media, but it's been a fantastic journey, a pleasure to edit these two books and to also get to know you better, and have become a student of geoeconomics myself, and hope to continue to read your writings in future. Thank you very much.